Greg Elba with the Center for Social Justice, Socialist Project, and York University, who are all, and the Workers' Assembly, all who are hosting this discussion today on the Maidan rising, uprising and civil war in the Ukraine, questions for the left. Those of us, of course, around the world, but particularly given the position of the Canadian government of following the Maidan developments and the Ukraine developments quite closely since the turmoil, and I guess it was the fall and winter of 2013 and through 2014, of course, opening up a couple of major fractures. One of them, of course, being the geopolitical fracture that was widened partly vis-a-vis NATO's aggressive expansion towards Eastern Europe, which has raised issues vis-a-vis Russia's particular position on the NATO expansion. As we know, that is what the Canadian government has been particularly aggressive about on the NATO expansion. We've moved CF-18s into Romania on a forward position. We've also moved combat troops in that direction towards the Ukraine as part of the NATO position. This, of course, has continued to lead to a spiral of sanctions and counter-sanctions back and forth that haven't stopped. So the geopolitical tension surrounding the developments in the Ukraine remain very, very important. The other is, of course, we've all been watching often with the what I guess has to be called an eternal civil war division, partly vis-a-vis what happened in the Crimea, the break-off of Crimea coming into the Russian fold, but also the divisions in eastern Ukraine, Donetsk and Luhansk, in particular the armed militias there with the particular governmental orientation, which have deepened the crisis, and something our speaker is particularly knowledgeable about and writes and speaks about a lot, that is the development and forms of the far right in the Ukraine, the Ukrainian government. So these are very, very important events and issues, and we're lucky to have Volodymyr Ishchenko here to speak about these things. He's a sociologist studying social protests in the Ukraine. He is the deputy director of the Center for Social and Labor Research, a member of the Editorial Board of Commons, which is the English name, not the Ukrainian name, which he'll speak about, which is a journal of social criticism. He's also active on LeftEast, which is a website which many of us regularly consult for articles and reports on developments in Eastern Europe and Russia. It's a really terrific a site, and he has commented and authored a number of interviews and so forth. Some of the most important being one of the most important commentators of some of his writings that have appeared in The Guardian, but also in the midst of the turmoil, a long interview that Volodymyr did with New Left Review that circulated everywhere in English language, a great deal to help us understand those events. So we're very fortunate to have Volodymyr here. Let's give him a comradely welcome.
Thank you very much for this very warm introduction. Thank you very much for everyone coming to listen about Ukraine and what's happening there. I would suggest from the very beginning that you can just interrupt me in any moment and ask questions as far as we have this comfortable round, like circle space. I have my kind of 40 minutes talk, but it would enable us to speak more about the things which are less known and most interesting for you, and like not only about the things which are most interesting for me. And this is not a kind of like any kind of academic talk. This is a perspective of, from the left, my perspective on what is happening, what has happened in Ukraine in the previous year. And this is a perspective which would probably not be shared by the majority of the left in Ukraine. And a perspective on what has happened from the view of competing nationalism and competing imperialism and their the impact they make on the political process in Ukraine. And unfortunately what we have seen that the Ukrainian left has precisely split and went into the camps of either Ukrainian nationalism and Western imperialism, or in the camp of Russian nationalism and imperialism of Russian Federation. That's precisely the thing that the left movement could not have done in any case, but unfortunately it actually happened. And what actually happened in Ukraine, I think, at least for me, it seems that the lessons that we have to draw from these events and the mistakes that the left did in Ukraine, they are important not only for Ukraine and not only for Eastern Europe or not only for neighboring countries, but it seems that they are dealing with the questions which are important for the global left and for progressive activists in many countries, and raising the issues of the necessity for political parties, and the danger of nationalism, the nature of contemporary imperialism, what is contemporary fascism, and so on. And all these questions were very much actual and not just theoretical, but actually the practical questions of the left in Ukraine in the previous months, and probably they will be the questions which we'll have to find some solution in the coming days. So I'll just speak briefly about what was Maidan, how the left perceived it, what was anti-Maidan, which started after Yanukovych was removed from power, and how the left perceived it in the opposite way. And why it happened that the left was actually split among the opposing enemy camps, alien for the left. So, speaking about Maidan and the reasons why it started, there were a number of reasons to protest against Yanukovych. Yanukovych was, despite that all these talks, which are quite often repeated in Western media, and in particular among the left in the West, that he was democratically elected. He was democratically elected, but it doesn't mean that if you're seriously speaking about revolutions, that we have to make a fetish from this democratic election. He was a corrupt politician. He was a politician which tried to monopolize the power and tried to take as much as possible power positions also against other competing capitalist groups in Ukraine. In the middle of Maidan, he made a quite clear anti-democratic move, pressuring the parliament to vote for a number of clearly anti-democratic laws limiting political freedoms and civic rights. And the economic situation in Ukraine was very much kind of stagnating. One of the major elements of Yanukovych rhetoric was stability. But that was not a stability of a rich country, but that was stability of a quite poor country. Ukraine suffered a lot from economic crisis in 2008. The GDP decrease in 2009, next year after the crisis touched Ukraine, was decreasing 15%. It was almost the lowest level in Europe. And afterwards, it didn't seem that the Ukrainian economy was able to recover after the crisis. Some small growth started, but in 2015 it was evident that without foreign credits, either from EU or from Russia, Ukraine would not be just able to pay with all the foreign debts. So the alternative were only either we receive a huge credit from EU and from Russia, and it appeared that Russian proposal was more preferable for a number of reasons, or Ukraine would be required to declare default. So that was a kind of political economy preconditions of Maidan. And there were also a number of social protests against Yanukovych. Some of them were not only of the local type, but also taking the scale of nationwide protests, and very quickly politicizing and demanding not just immediate social economic solutions, but also demanding to impeach the president, to resign the cabinet of ministers, to disperse the parliament. This was the protest of small business and self-employed people in 2010 against the increase of taxes for the small business, and actually not increasing the taxes for the rich, for the big business with the grand bourgeoisie. In 2011, the Chernobyl disaster liquidators and the Soviet Afghanistan war veterans were protesting to retain their special pensions they were receiving for suffering for the society. And the state was trying to take away these pensions. And in 2013, we saw a number of local social economic protests, which were actually rising in the number compared to previous years. We do a systematic monitoring of these protest events, and so I'm speaking about some real data, it's not just perception. In 2014, we saw the largest number of social economic protests, even before Maidan started, than we were seeing in previous several years. But this social dissatisfaction with Yanukovych's regime was channeled into the geopolitical agenda of protest for European association against association with Russian customs union. And in the beginning, Maidan was very, like, the ideology of Maidan was first, it was Euro illusions, a kind of expectations that European association and integration with the European Union would bring Ukraine to a kind of almost utopia. It's a European dream that joining EU would mainly solve the major problems in Ukraine. And at least it would be the first step for that. And in the same time, it was, from the very beginning, it was inherently connected with anti-Russian nationalism. So in the discussions, EU were always counterposed to customs union. And of course, in this comparison, Russia was not actually winning. And especially like comparing the living standards, but also the Russia were perceived as a kind of like Tolkien's Mordor on the earth. Not of that kind as like Iraq during Saddam Hussein's rule or Northern Korea now, but something's moving into that direction. And many Ukrainians felt that we have to move in the other directions, although making quite naive expectations in that point. And also from the very quickly, that protest, which was started by journalists, by some students, and more or less of a civic grassroots nature, but in the very few starting days, it was very quickly overtaken by traditional opposition in Ukraine, by moderate opposition like Tymoshenko party or Vitaly Klitschko party, but also that coalition was naturally joined by the far right Svoboda party. And actually, moderate opposition were cooperating with Svoboda, with the far rights, for many years before. And it was that was actually the point of my talk in Ottawa yesterday, that significant far right participation in Maidan was not an invention of Russian media. It was true, and it was very much natural, considering all the very strong cooperation between liberal position in the far right in the previous years. And it was quite evident from the very beginning that it will not lead to any kind of social revolution. It was evident that, moreover, that it will not lead to any kind of even political revolution. If we speak about change of the institutions, and that's one of my major points, that we have to seriously think about the revolutions, especially in the context of all these mass movements around the world, which we have seen in the previous several years. Because revolution is not just any anti-governmental mass movement, but it inherently must mean some rapid fundamental transformation of either social structure and institution, or at least political structure and institutions. And let's call it in the latter case a political revolution, but in any case, this is not just change of the people who are in the power offices, it should be a fundamental radical change of the institutions. And this is not what happened in Ukraine, and this is not what also was happening in, for example, Arab countries, which experienced so-called Arab Spring. We saw rather the revolutions without revolutions, revolutions without revolutionary changes. But just to change the like one elite for another traditional elite is not something we would prefer to call a revolution, and not something that we would actually desire to support. And in this situation, when it was quite, all the things were quite evident, there was a question for the left. Why to participate in a movement without any potential for progressive structural transformation, and where the left was actually unable to influence on anything on political level, but instead there were a high temptation to compromise our ideas and our identity, to become just supporters of the right and more of the far right. And this inability to change something on political level was also quite expected, considering the weakness of the left in Ukraine, and also its very much divided nature. So even before the Maidan started, the left was quite divided between Borodba initiative. Probably someone who have already heard about them. They became quite internationally known, and also because they received repressions from the new government. Borodba means struggle, and they were attempting to build a political party. And of course, they were receiving strong criticism from more left liberal and libertarian left for that, and they were accused in trying to hijack the joint campaigns and use the joint protests for their own publicity and so on. And it's a very, very common accusation of political parties. And some parts of the left actually tried to intervene to Maidan, tried to participate there. I would call them the Euro left. And actually many of them were making this case that we have this option, either to choose between EU or Russia. And now let's think, EU is seemingly better than Russia, or at least it's better in defending minority rights, it's better in gender equality, especially in that, and comparing to the recent conservative laws which were implemented in Russia, for example, so-called propaganda of homosexuality, which actually a law which was passed a couple of years ago there. And of course, in this comparison, Russia was perceived as a kind of like conservative hell. And the EU, of course, is better in political democracy, in formal democratic institutions. But in the same time, they were not challenging the economic basis of the European Union. This is in any way a neoliberal project, and more or less this is an imperialist project. And in the same time, why they made this case for the left might have some reasons to support Maidan. At the same time, they were forced to whitewash the movement, particularly the downplaying the far-right participation there. Not to the same extent as liberals were doing this, but still they were arguing that the far-right participation was not actually so significant, that the far-right were not really fascists, they were just ethnic nationalists or just national conservatives. And the far right that were participating there, they didn't have actual potential to come to the power, so it's not really dangerous that they are participating there. And finally, making the point that all the speculation about so-called Ukrainian fascists might be just playing for the Russian propaganda, which was from the very beginning very hostile to this movement. But instead of making a case for Maidan to break with the far right, decisively break with them, they were not seriously challenging them. And in this way, they were more silencing and downplaying their presence than actually really helping the movement. And that's ignorance and tolerance towards far right, and later played a very important role in inspiring the anti-Maidan movement, and it was one of the reasons, not probably the primary reasons, but at least one of the reasons that many people in the eastern, in southern Ukraine were more and more hostile to what was happening in Kyiv and creating a ground for the civil war, which is still going on now. And it's also important to say that Maidan agenda has changed in the middle of January. After Yanukovych pressed on the parliament to pass 10 so-called dictatorship laws, limiting political freedoms and civic rights, the protest was, European agenda was not on the first place in the protest. It was became a clear protest for retaining the democracy and a protest against Yanukovych. Nevertheless, that European agenda has never been taken away from the movement, and no one was actually challenging it. So in any case, the new government has continued with that. But anyway, it was very much clear in January that what Yanukovych was doing was trying to prevent any kind of radical political activity to happen in Ukraine, and including also the left activity, and it was also the protest to retain the space that we could, where we could intervene and where we could actually work as leftist radical activists. And at this point, the question about the lack of independent left political organization with necessary resources, with ability to mobilize resources, mobilize people, mobilize audience, and that would be able to propose an independent left agenda for the movement, it became very, very much crucial at that moment. We didn't have it. And it also brings into the discussions all this fetishism of network structures, of horizontal grassroots participation, which is, of course, it's not something bad. But in the same time, when we are in a critical situation, when we see a mass movement against the government rising, and we do not have any tool for really meaningful and significant participation there, that's all those discussions about we do not need any party, that becomes not just like silly, but they become kind of like almost a crime. Because that was our situation in the middle of January, when the left was not actually able to suggest anything, to make any meaningful difference in that moment, I would say. So in the end, what happened? That some of the leftists were simply joining the far-right violence, which they started in the center of Kyiv, and played the role of just foot soldiers in that violence, not bringing anything left, any leftist perspective there. Some left activists joined humanitarian initiatives, for example, supporting those activists which were injured and might have been repressed by the police. And some chose just to criticize everything on the internet, which was actually again not an option to pursue in the situation when the government is indeed seriously challenged. And some initiatives which were trying to bring the leftist agenda to the movement were. They existed, but they were quite marginal. They didn't make any significant difference. And my position at that moment was that we should not abstain from the struggle. But in the same time, we cannot be just the foot soldiers for the liberals, or even more for the far right. We had to try to initiate an alternative struggle against Yanukovych, and try to propose an alternative strategy and bring our own agenda with at least some chances to become hegemonic. So, for example, when the violence started, we were thinking about non-violent but still efficient solution, and political strikes were seemingly a kind of such solution that we could try to organize and try to work with there and try to spread this strike initiatives. And actually one strike initiative started in my university where the left had like for several years they had some support among the students also in supporting their struggles for student rights. But that strike initiative was, in the end, it was unsuccessful. We were able to, we had an ambitious plan to occupy the university, to close it down, and then to spread this political strike all around other universities. And moreover, let's try to spread it for the workers' enterprises, so to start the labor strikes. That would be actually something really dangerous for the government. And no other opposition party was actually able to start a strike, despite the several times they were trying to initiate, but they were not even able to close their own enterprises. They were actually the opposition leaders, which were part of the bourgeoisie, and they owned these enterprises, but they didn't went to this strategy. Like Poroshenko, who is the sixth richest person in Ukraine, he didn't shut down even his own enterprises for a strike. And in the end, in our university, the strike initiative failed. We were able to occupy just the main stairs in the main building for a week. Then university administration didn't support it. And what was even worse, that the majority of students didn't support it. And our university is a kind of like pretending to be elite, so it's small, and it was for many years it was claiming that he is raising the national conscious elite for future Ukraine. And that's, of course, it brings a question which perspective has the left movement when its social base is concentrated in the elite universities, where the majority of students in the critical moment appear to be conformist and careerist. They were, mainly they were just afraid of that the Ministry of Education or the government would close down our university and they would lose their positions. So the strike initiatives was quite scary for them. To participate in the mass movement was more acceptable. And in the end of February, Yanukovych was removed from power and the new government was established. There were many discussions on the left about the nature of this government, about the exact participation of the far right in this government. And some of the left called it fascist junta, which was not only wrong, but it had also political, very dangerous political consequences for starting the civil war in Ukraine. Far-right Svoboda Party indeed had several positions within the government, but it would not be possible to argue that they made some real influence on the politics of this government, particularly in the far-right direction. So I would call it a neoliberal nationalist government, its predominance of neoliberals. But in any case, it was not a junta, not a military government, and it was not predominantly fascist. And but yeah, when you call some government a fascist junta, it necessarily means that you have to start a kind of like military struggle against it. If a fascist junta came to power in your country, what the left is going to do? Just go to the underground, take the arms, and start the armed uprising there. And yeah, the uprising started in the eastern Ukraine, in the southern Ukraine also. There's in the mainstream media, it's heavily perceived as a Russian, either Russian intervention or Russian special operation. In any case, the Russian factor is emphasized and exaggerated. But I'm not denying in any way that Russian presence was really important for that movement, and Russians indeed supported it, if not the government, but still, even Russian business, Russian private persons, they supported it with money, they supported it with weapons. And when the heavy weapons actually started to come to eastern Ukraine, it was more or less understandable that the Russian government has something to do with that. It just cannot allow tanks or this kind of like military machines just to cross over the border. It just cannot happen without the Russian commanders and personally Putin not knowing about it. But it cannot be reduced to Russian factor, and that is an important point to make. And there were real grievances against the new government which came to power. Also social grievances, not just of identity nature, not just of language, cultural nature. Donbas, the eastern Ukrainian region, is the most urbanized region in Ukraine. In Donetsk province, for example, over 90% of the people live in the cities. For example, compared with the less than 50% in western Ukraine, living in urban settlements. This is the most industrialized region, dominated with mostly still Soviet industry, which was not innovated, which was not modernized for more than 20 years, but was gradually deteriorating. But still these industries were working for Russian market, some of them which were not closed. Many of them were closed. So that's an urban, very much industrialized, proletarianized, and in the same time not actually rich, but quite poor region. It received donations from the central budget, despite the regional identity for which it was kind of like important that Donbas feeds Ukraine. It was not so easy. Donbas received quite important donations from the central government. And when the people started to protest, they were speaking very much about these social issues. But also the issues of the language, or perceived threat to Russian language was also important. They were scared with the attacks on the communist monuments, which were still in place in many cities in the eastern and southern Ukraine, and which were still a part of collective identity, which didn't accept that nationalist history narrative, which was promoted since 1991 in Ukraine, and which was more or less accepted in Western and Central regions. There were also so-called Donbassophobia, a perception from other parts of Ukraine which saw the Donetsk people as kind of vulgar, as almost bandits, like less educated, less kind of like civilized. So a number of racist stereotypes which became an everyday phenomenon for some people in Ukraine.
Why was that?
There was as I said, there is an objective difference between regions in Ukraine, right? And of course, the region which was heavily industrialized, and in the same time meeting the problems of unemployment, of closing enterprises, of deteriorating education, of course, it produced like the youth which was kind of less educated, like for some normal perception of like middle class educated Kyiv person, for example. But In the same time, it was all exaggerated and exploited by the politicians. This division between the West and the East became very, very prominent during 2004 elections, so-called Orange Revolution, when already the both actually Yushchenko and Yanukovych played on this regional divisions and essentialized stereotypes about Western Ukrainians and Eastern Ukrainians. So Western Ukrainians were often perceived as kind of like fascists, that they are nationalists, they supported all those Nazi collaborants during the Second World War, the Banderovci, I don't know if you know this, yeah. Bandera movement. And that was again, that was another kind of essentialized stereotype about the Western Ukrainians. For the Eastern Ukrainians were perceived in this way of a kind of like social racism, especially by middle class and higher educated people, for example, in Kyiv or in Western Ukraine. They speak in different language, Russian language. They listen to vulgar music.
What kind of music is that?
You probably don't listen to it. For example, the most prominent was so-called chanson, which is kind of like bandit songs. Like seen in quite bad manner with like heavy male voices and speaking about some true story of a person who were in jail and then came out of jail. So probably a structural comparison would be against the rap, but it's not rap, it's a different musical genre. But yeah, and this kind of music was popular, and of course it was essentialized, and of course actually the poorer people were listening to this music also in Kyiv and in Western Ukraine, despite its usual in Russian language. And the point is that the politicians were exploiting these regional divisions, mobilizing their corresponding electorate. And it was actually very, very politically reasonable to essentialize this division and try to mobilize the people in their social bases, either in Western Ukraine or in Eastern Ukraine. And to exaggerate, for example, the danger of coming, of the president coming from Western Ukraine for the Eastern Ukrainians, that, for example, even in 2004, Yanukovych team was using the image of Yushchenko, Viktor Yushchenko, as a fascist. Although he was kind of like, he was not a fascist, he was a moderate nationalist. Yeah, he was pro-UN, pro-UPA, having this traditional nationalist agenda of supporting this nationalist collaborants during the Second World War, but you cannot say that he was really anti-democratic, really reactionary, really xenophobic. He was not a far-right politician. But of course, in the political campaign, it was very, very, very reasonable to make this point that he is a danger, he is a threat. When he'll come to power, he'll ban Russian language, he'll destroy all the communist monuments, and so on. And again, the threats, these dangers, became partially reality, but to a large extent, they were also exaggerated in February and March for many people were seeing what was happening in Kyiv and all those violence and all those far-right activists, mainly from the television. They were scared. There was also a very, very strong factor of irrational emotions. But again, it cannot be just reduced to irrationality. People in Eastern Ukraine had some reasonable causes to protest against neoliberal nationalist government. And those people on the left would just didn't understand these causes, and I very much doubt are they on the left at all. So, but again, this to make my point, this just causes were, as in the case of Maidan, they were channeled into nationalist agenda, again into the struggle of geopolitical nature. And the agenda of the rebels separatist movement was very much Russian nationalist, culturally conservative. And what we saw there was competing nationalism, which were breeding and feeding each other. Ukrainian nationalism and Ukrainian nationalist threat was feeding Russian-speaking minority nationalism. And in the same time, when Russia annexed Crimea, they showed a way for Russian nationalists that they could repeat this Crimean scenario, organize a referendum and proclaim an independence from Ukraine. And this feeded Ukrainian nationalism. When finally they could point to and say that, yes, we told you for many years Russia is a threat. It's a threat for our independence, it's a threat for our integrity, it's a threat for Ukraine. So, yeah, you were right. And what they were talking for many years became quite obvious and real. So what we see in Ukraine now is more a competition of equally dangerous nationalism and not a struggle of oppressed and oppressor nation. It's actually a big problem for me whether we can actually speak in the case of Ukraine about oppressed nation and oppressor nation. It's not actually clear for me that Ukrainian nations, which is oppressed, or the Russian minority, which is oppressed.
Yes. It's not clear, but you're saying it's not clear to you that the Ukrainian nation is oppressed?
Yes. Yeah, I can explain it if it's, yes, if it's a question. Because, for example, like let's take a question of language, which was very important in this debate, and the attempt to cancel the law which gave Russian language an official status was, which actually didn't happen. They revised the decision, but nevertheless, that was one of the issues which could mobilize and could create some real threat for Eastern Ukrainians. But what is the real situation? Almost everyone in Ukraine is bilingual. Almost everyone understands both Ukrainian and Russian language. They were close languages. They became divided. I'm not a historian, but as far as I know, they became separate languages just only in the Middle Ages, 15th century, something like that. And almost everyone is able to understand and read another language. Roughly half of population prefers to speak in Ukrainian, roughly half of population prefers to speak in Russian. On the level of state institutions, Ukrainian language was dominating. It was the only state language. And it has to be used by the state officials, it has to be used in the courts, it has to be used in all the state administration offices, and so on. But in the market sphere, in the sphere of consumption, like for example, in the number of books in Russian language, the number of print press in Russian language, the qualitative television shows in Russian language, they were dominating over Ukrainian language media products. So it was actually for Ukrainians, it was not as easy to receive quality Ukrainian language media products than, for example, it was for Russian speakers. Even for example, if coming to a books market in Kyiv, the majority of books production which you could buy there were in Russian language, and there were special kiosks which were specialists in Ukrainian language books. They were selling exclusively Ukrainian language books. And that is the capital of Ukraine. And that's really something. That's a problem.
Yes.
So that's why it's not actually clear for me whether we can speak in this situation where one, for example, language community is oppressed and another is an oppressor. You can make a totally opposite argument. Either Russian community is oppressed or Ukrainian community is oppressed. They are oppressed in various ways. And it's a much more complex situation than these very old terms. So what we saw on Anti-Maidan, it was, like 5 minutes and take more time. So we saw again another movement with a complex combination of progressive and reactionary elements. And like Maidan was not a revolution, anti-Maidan was not a counter-revolution. And, but in the same time, it was not any kind of like proletarian revolution, as some actually quite a large number on the left were perceiving it, probably following Boris Kagarlitsky analysis, which was, became quite known. That was a movement again based on more on regional identity and driven into nationalist agenda. And the left reacted in totally opposite way to Maidan. So Borodva organization, they attempted to intervene into anti-Maidan, and they were actually more successful in terms of getting into some leadership positions in terms of their visibility, especially in the cities of Kharkov, which is a large city in the east of Ukraine, or in Odessa, which is a large city in southern Ukraine. That was possible due to quite a decentralized and horizontal nature of that movement in the beginning, when it was starting in the end of February and in March. But in any case, even they were not able to claim, they were not able to claim that they were close to hegemony. And the problem with their participation, that they were not actually really critical and really distant from more and more strong Russian nationalists that were getting into the leadership positions. And after the armed uprising started in the middle of April, kind of like after more than a month of peaceful rallies and occupations of governmental buildings, they started the armed uprising. It might be possible as like again a provocation, a special operation from the Russian security services. We still do not know, was Strelkov just a Russian nationalist volunteer? Was he indeed kind of like a conspiracy or whatever? But after the armed uprising started, Borodva became more and more marginal in that movement. They were not able to compete with Russian nationalists, which started to control their money resources, their weapons resources, and they didn't join the armed struggle. And in the same time, they were repeating all this bullshit about the fascist junta in Kyiv, and when it was definitely not an anti-fascist struggle against fascists. It was a civil war based on the regional identity, and you couldn't find actually good and bad side in this civil war. And they met quite heavy repression, and many of them were moved to immigrate, mostly to Crimea. Some people are in European Union. Some people were actually arrested and detained, and there is perceived quite widespread understanding that probably the security services of Ukraine were trying to make a provocation, putting them explosives. That's, for example, a case of one of Odessa activists from Borodva movement. And but in the same time, the another part of Ukrainian left, the Euro left, they were increasingly seen anti-Maidan via kind of chauvinist lenses. They were repeating against anti-Maidan all those accusations which they were justifying for Maidan movement before that. So they were pointing to and often exaggerating the Russian influence, or even reducing all that was happening in eastern Ukraine to Russian intervention. They were pointing to reactionary nature, that conservative agenda of that movement, of the fascist tendencies within the separatist movement, while downplaying any progressive elements within it. And they were quite often seeing it as a counter-revolution, as if a neoliberal nationalist government in Kyiv was revolutionary. And they were not understanding that when, for example, anti-Maidan people were shouting Russia, Russia, they were not more irrational and not more reactionary than Maidan protesters when they were appealing to Europe. And if Europe promised, for example, non-corrupt politics or democratic institutions, including defense of minority rights, Russia promised high wages and pensions now. And for workers in the eastern Ukraine, that was also very much important. Many on the Euro left supported anti-terrorist operation against separatists and were quite uncritical to anti-democratic initiatives of the new government that they were justifying by the war situation. And what they did not see is that the Ukraine became a playground for competing imperialisms, Russian and Western. Like Western, it's kind of like a general term, but probably EU and US have sometimes common interests, but they may be also differentiated. But in any case, competing imperialism. And while Russian imperialism was more open and military, but actually weaker than Western, but the stronger US and European imperialists, they were, didn't even needed to intervene militarily, at least at this moment. If they got a servile and totally dependent on their financial help government in Kyiv. So it appeared that for many on the left, that actually they don't have a sophisticated understanding of what the contemporary imperialism is. And if a stronger state is invading a weaker state, it's imperialism. But if actually the stronger states in the world are able to control the, or at least to not directly to control, but make a very much dependent government in the capital, and not to intervene militarily, they do not see any problem with this. So in the end, we saw that the Ukrainian left was appearing to be split between competing imperialism and nationalism camps, and playing as not as an independent actor with their own agenda, but rather as a left wing of either Ukrainian nationalists and Western imperialism, or of Russian nationalists and Russian imperialists. And I see it as not only the problem of Ukrainian left and their, and our previous history, but also that some of the tendencies were actually starting in the global left even in the 60s. And for example, the postmodern liberal left started to emphasize more and more non-class issues, like gender and minority issues, in expense of the class agenda, and forgetting that the class conflict is actually the central conflict in a capitalist society. While anti-imperialist left were more and more focused on the struggle against the United States, and very often ready to support all the American forces that they have all around the world, despite their reactionary nature, and forgetting again about this class dimension of anti-imperialist struggle. That yes, if you are against U.S. imperialism, it doesn't mean that we have to support Russian imperialists. And now we are in the situation when we have to. Actually, all these issues are important. Both anti-imperialist struggle and both the more developed minority rights agenda of European left. But we have to perceive them from the class perspective and to embed them into our independent anti-capitalist politics. To become them, to form rather. To look at them rather as the questions for the anti-capitalist left and not to pose them into the dominance for our priority agenda. And I think that is happening not only in Ukrainian and Eastern European left, but that's very much a problem for the movements in Western Europe and in Northern America, and no less about like other regions in the world, but it seems this is the general problems that we have to discuss and we have to overcome. Because if you are not thinking about them in this moment, in the critical moment when the masses of people are protesting against the government, the European in the situation where we cannot suggest anything meaningful for the people, and we cannot make any meaningful political difference in the critical moment. So that was my points, and thank you for attention. Sorry for...